My dear students of class 9, A and B, today I am going to revise the life and achievements of Emperor Ashoka. In my previous class, I revised about the life of achievements of life and achievements of Chandragupta Maurya, Bindusara. Today I am going to do it for Ashoka. Who was Ashoka? Ashoka was the son of Emperor Bindusara. Like father, like son. But Bindusara himself declared him more efficient than him. So Ashoka, during his rule, imprisoned many innocent people who were against him, who antagonized him. He imprisoned them. It is clear that Ashoka's accession to the throne was after a long, long and brutal struggle. That's why Ashoka proved that he was an efficient ruler, not only but also an able general, and gave good leadership while fighting against his enemies. Ashoka was a great general and was not a pacifist by any standards. He not only, consolidated his empire, but began to extend the frontiers of his empire. As a result of it, it became a vast empire under his rule. Although Ashoka left the policy of fighting, the policy of war, declaring war against his enemies, and adopted the policy of non-violence, on being impressed and encouraged, inspired by the concept of Buddhism. Ashoka extended his empire from the northwestern frontier, northwestern mountains of Hindu Kush to the river Penar of Mysore, and made a very large kingdom. A very important port of empire was Dambavati, which was an important port of the coast of Bengal that connected Sri Lanka and Burma to India via ships. So Ashoka, it is proof that Ashoka gave importance to international trade. Ashoka maintained a friendly relations with kingdoms of southern India, namely Pandas, Cholas and Kerala Putras. They all became companions of Ashoka. However, it was his desire for conquest that changed his world view from Digvijay. The origin of many symbols of modern India, such as those used in the national flag, Ashoka, and on coins and paper money, can be traced to his reign. Now, what was the importance of Kalinga War? Kalinga War was a war fought between Ashoka and his enemies. Before Ashoka, the previous ruler of the Mauryan dynasty never thought of fighting against the Kalingans, because they were not only warlike people but very dangerous and very mischievous. Chandragupta Maurya never thought of attacking Kalinga, because that time the situation was quite different than that of the situation during the reign of Ashoka. But Bindusara made an attempt, but he realized that it was not the right time to attack Kalinga. But Ashoka, from the very beginning, was determined to fight against the Kalingans and to capture Kalinga, because there were huge natural resources from Kalinga. He was very much interested. He had great interest for Kalinga only because of that reason. Ultimately, the horror of Kalingan War deaths of millions of people, changed his mind, left the policy of war, and adopted the policy of, you know, policy of non-violence, non-aggression. This is known as Dharma Vijay. The origins of many symbols of modern India, such as those in the national flag, Ashoka's glory and image, is showing that the attitude of non-violence, the changing attitude from violence to non-violence, was the main symbol and glory of a country like India. That's why Ashoka still now is given importance. You know, Ashoka was impressed by the concept of Buddhism. He embraced the teachings of Gautam Buddha and renounced war and violence. Besides, Ashoka's main thing that was very important, that was Ashoka implemented the principle of Ahimsa by banning hunting and violent sports. Ashoka became a preacher of Dhamma, the Prakriti equivalent of the Sanskrit word Dharma. Extend friendly relations with kingdom across Asia and Europe, as I told you earlier. He undertook a massive public works campaign across the country. Ashoka's fame reached far and wide only because of his administrative skill. Now, I am going to discuss about the Mauryan administration. The Mauryan administration was centralized. The Mauryan administration was centralized. The Mauryan Empire had an efficient administrative system. It functioned at four levels, like central, provincial, village, and district. Administration of the city of Pataliputra was controlled by the emperor himself, because the system of administration of the capital city Pataliputra was quite different than that of the system of centralized administration for, you know, central, provincial, district, and village. Now, the ministers were held. Who were the ministers? The Amartyas were known as the ministers. The ministers were helped by the Amartyas. Who were the Amartyas? They were executive officers. So, the ministers were assisted by the executive officers, who supervise various government works and departments or functions as judges. And the central administration was divided into 32 departments, known as Adhyaksha. The empire was divided into four provinces, like Magadha, Takshila, Ujjain, and Sarnagiri, headed by Thankars. The spy system during the reign of Ashoka was very powerful. The spy system, Ashoka appointed so many spies in order to learn the condition of the common people, whether they were happy, whether they were unhappy. Ashoka wanted to learn if any kind of mismanagement was there in his administration, if any kind of misery was there, distress was there for the people. Ashoka wanted to learn it and he came to know it from through his reliable spies. Their spies worked on behalf of the king, Ashoka. That's why the spy system of Ashoka was very powerful. A very good network of spy system introduced by Ashoka. Now, central administration. Ashoka's central administration means various branches of administration, such as revenues, military, under their officials called Amartyas, Mahamantas, Pradeshikas, Rajukas, and Yoktas. They worked on behalf of the king. And provincial administration, head of the provincial administration was Kumara, means royal prince. And he governed the provinces as the king's representatives. The Kumara was assisted by whom? By Mahamantas or Mantri Parishad. Now the district administration, Ashoka district administration, it was due to the capability of Mauryan administration. Each province was divided into many villages. The Pradeshika was the head of each district and was assisted by the junior officials such as Yoktas, Rajukas. Who were Rajukas? They are district magistrate of law and order. Some important functions at the district level were survey and assessment of land, collection of revenue and maintenance of law and order. So taxes were imposed on the peasants and farmers as per the quality of lands. They calculated the amount of money as revenues or taxes of the lands as per the quality. If the lands were barren or fertile lands. Fertile land taxes for fertile lands were imposed high, but not barren land. No taxes was imposed on barren lands. But Dhamma and Mahamantra promoted Dhamma for welfare of the people. Why? Because they worked hard and they introduced a good system, a good network of administration on behalf of the king. That's why each district consisted of many villages. Villages, so that villagers must be provided with good judgment and the rights they deserve to utilize. Now the village administration, the village headman called Gramika was assisted by a council, and he was the head of village administration. Who? The village headman. Who? By which name was he called? He was called by Gramika or Gramini. And their functions included assisting government officials in making the administration very powerful, the boundaries of the village, maintaining land records and collecting taxes. These were the most important assignments and works of the Gramikas or Gramini. Historians became that the organization of the Mauryan Empire was in the line with the extension of bureaucracy described by Kautilya and Arthashastra. It was due to the efficient work of Kautilya. Kautilya wrote it in detailed form in his famous book Arthashastra about the village administration, about central administration, about provincial administration, about the role of king, and about the system of spy system of King Emperor Ashoka. So these all are discussed thoroughly in his famous book Arthashastra by Kautilya, and that's why we come to know about the Mauryan administration of Ashoka by reading the book Arthashastra. So these are the important system of Mauryan administration, for which Mauryan administration became very strong, powerful. And Ashoka was able to establish law and order in the country, although he became a great follower of non-violent method. But still, law and order was established. People were happy, rich, prosperous, because their earnings were too much high, and poverty was not there. People were rich, prosperous, happy. They earned a lot of money and paid huge amount of taxes for the welfare of the country. For the welfare of all-round development of the country, growth of the country. And that's why the reign of Ashoka was a reign of the people, and Ashoka was able to be a great ruler of the country our country has ever produced. Next day I shall continue the remaining part of the lesson. And then, your lesson of 4 will be complete, teaching of lesson 4 will be completed. And next day, and afterwards, from Monday onwards, I shall start lesson number 5, the new lesson. And if you have any confusion, any problem, any difficulty, let me know. Send it and ask me question through my email, and I shall try my level best to clarify it in a very brief form, because not enough space is not, you know. And if you have any doubt regarding any point of discussion, any point of understanding, please let me know. I shall help you as fast as possible. Thank you, my dear sir.